Okay, well, let's go ahead and get started. Welcome to today's presentation hosted by Solix Technologies. Today we'll be discussing case studies and database application archiving. With us we will have Brian Babineau from Enterprise Strategy Group, where he will be discussing some of his latest findings from ESG's Digital Archiving Market Forecast Report, along with some of the case studies in the enterprise archiving from companies that have implemented data archiving strategies. Just a couple of things about today's webinar. Hopefully everyone has been able to join the webinar portion. We have muted the phone lines, so if you do have any questions, please submit them through the chat line that is available through one of the icons in the lower right-hand corner of your webinar. For better viewing, you should be able to select view and full screen mode to see the entire presentation. So if we could go ahead to the next slide, I'd like to just take a quick moment. So hello today. My name is Julie Lochner. I'm Vice President of Solix Technologies. I will begin today's presentation with a brief overview of Solix's Enterprise Data Management Suite. We'll just spend a few minutes on that, and then we'll really spend most of our time. I'll turn it over to Brian Babineau, Senior Analyst at Enterprise Strategy Group. He will review the case studies in database application archiving from a market perspective. Before we talk about the solution from Solix, one of the things that we have noticed over the years of working in this market is that, you know, any customer who has a database application who's been running in a production environment for some time notices that as that production database grows in size, without upgrading the infrastructure, the storage, or the server behind that large database, one of the first things that gets impacted is application performance. And that can be seen as, you know, not only the application slowing down, but business processes slowing down, online queries. And again, you know, if you upgrade the infrastructure, you can take care of that performance, but after you've upgraded the infrastructure or tuned the database application at the end of the day, usually the performance or the performance degradation is related to the size of your growing database. The second challenge that we've seen from many of our customers is most companies that we work with have made multiple copies of their production environment for standby or DR or test and development training, but the processes that they use to make those clones are either manual or a lot of customers that we talk with use a backup from tape, and they'll restore it into a test and development environment, and they'll restore that environment as is. The problem with that is this process is now an area where it's not being monitored or audited, and it does invite security risks. On the target, when you look at a full clone from production, you know, if you have a terabyte production database and you're making four copies, you know, staging environment, testing or development environment or training environment, those are full clones as well. You'll start to see, you know, your resource requirements grow exponentially as your production database grows, so do all those copies. So it's not just the storage requirements, but now you need bigger, more powerful servers to complete your test cycles. The other thing that is a concern is if you do have sensitive data in that production database and you do make full copies, that sensitive data is also in all of those copies. In many cases, we find that, you know, customers spend a lot of effort and time and money on protecting the production environments, but not necessarily on those test and development copies, exposing sensitive information to possible unauthorized access. Solix Enterprise Data Management Suite addresses not only the issues with the growth in the production size, but also your total cost of ownership from a test and development perspective by addressing it from a holistic approach. So before archiving, you have your 1 terabyte production database plus all those copies. With Solix Database Archiving, what we provide is the ability to archive historical or aged transactions to an online available active archive. And when we do that, we actually remove the data from production. So in this graphic you can see production now is 300 gigabytes with 1 year's worth of data, and everything that's 2 years or older or whatever the policy is that you define is in a single copy or a single archive. What we provide is, through your production application, transparent access to all that archive data. So even though the data has been moved to an archive, your end users still have access to it. But the other thing that you'll notice is that now all of those clones are smaller. We also provide the ability to do de-archive in case you need to bring it back. On the test and development side, Solix offers a secure subsetting solution, which means that not only are we automating the cloning process and auditing that entire process from the beginning of the clone to the end of the clone, but we're also providing the ability to create subsets, so smaller test and development copies, so that you don't need the full infrastructure requirements that you did before. But we do it in such a way that we maintain the transactional integrity. So all of your transactions will be complete, but just the sets of data are smaller. And then at the same time, if you have sensitive fields in there, we will mask that data or obfuscate it so that when you do release those test and development or training environments to other resources in the organization that may not have access or authorization to see sensitive data, they won't see it. It'll be masked or X'd out or changed altogether. This complete solution is offered from Solix as a unified platform. You know, the idea of having a unified platform, what that means is you only need to install the solution in a single server or a single location, and you can enable the archiving solution or the secure solution without having to install multiple products. And this makes managing those processes or those tasks that much easier. It's all centralized around a metadata manager. So the metadata about those applications, the tables that you're going to archive or mask or subset, the relationships between them, the definition of what an application transaction is all contained within our metadata manager. And then you enable the function that you need for that application, whether it's archiving or security, masking or subsetting. And then from a metadata manager perspective, packaged versus custom applications, that metadata is pre-populated for the packaged applications such as Oracle Business Suite, PeopleSoft, JD Edwards, Siebel, Bond. And for those applications that have been customized, or if you have an application that you've built homegrown, the same utility has a drag-and-drop user interface or a configurator that we use to populate that metadata, which makes it real easy to use and extend in your suite. As I mentioned, you know, the Solix Enterprise Data Management Suite is very comprehensive. We break our solutions down into both compliance categories and ILM category solutions, but it's really based on top of the same foundations. I mentioned the Enterprise Metadata Manager on the bottom, so you define the metadata for each of your application, but then you can enable the secure subsetting solution by enabling data masking or cloning or the instant subsetting. And we also provide, like I mentioned, you know, complete enterprise archiving capability supporting both custom and packaged database applications. We also include the ability to include reports or any attachments that are part of that ERP or financial application. Email attachments and documents can all be incorporated into that centralized archiving solution. As I mentioned before, you need to be able to audit not only the cloning process, but who's accessing the archived data. We have a complete built-in auditing solution so that we can monitor and track who's accessing the archived data to make sure no one's changing or altering the data, as well as monitoring the cloning process so that when you do create those clones and you mask the data, you have an audit trail to show that the data has been masked in those target environments. And then for those applications that are legacy, that are sitting out there consuming expensive resources on old, outdated technology, and we do provide the ability to use the same technology and platform to archive the data to a centralized archive repository and then sunset those old bits and binaries to lower your total operating cost. So when we tie it all together, as I mentioned, the Solix Enterprise Data Management Suite is a unified platform. It's comprised of an enterprise archiving solution that's really geared towards improving the business application and performance of that production system by offloading data from your production to a central archive, by auditing the cloning and masking solution, so you have a complete electronic paper trail of events from production through your test and development environment. And then a complete Solex EDMS secure subsetting solution, which includes the ability to create these smaller subset test and development environments while masking data to protect that sensitive information. If you do have questions, as I mentioned at the beginning, there is a chat box on the bottom right-hand corner. Go ahead and submit your questions, and we'll be taking those questions online as we go. What I'd like to do now is we will be turning our presentation over to Brian Babineau, Senior Analyst from Enterprise Strategy Group, and you know, we're really fortunate to have Brian with us today to discuss some of the case studies as part of his research in database application archiving. So, Brian, when you have control of the presentation, go ahead and we look forward to what you have to say.
Thanks, Julie, and I appreciate Solex having me here today, and thanks, everyone, for joining us.
This is for me joining the call today, especially after Julie gave such a great overview on the Solex technology, was my discussions with a number of Solex customers just to see how unified that platform was and if customers were really deriving business benefits. As an analyst, I get to do a lot of research, and I followed the database archiving market as well as the database management market for the past few years, and we get a lot of quantitative response that we can analyze and do market sizing and adoption rates and things like that. But when it comes down to spending some time with customers and determining what their needs were and how they utilize technology such as Solex, those case studies are invaluable from my perspective and show that and support some theses that we've come to that, you know, database archiving and as well as the management opportunities can satisfy a lot of different requirements. And my goal today is to really share with you some current market conditions and how those conditions create more and more application and database management challenges, as well as go through some of the business and IT benefits of the archiving solution and some questions that different constituents, whether it be compliance officers, IT managers, application owners, and security officers can ask to see if a solution like Solex is right for you. And then at the end, I have some recommendations on how to measure some of those business impacts as well as what you should be looking for in a solution. So with that, unfortunately, I start with some bad news. I tend to be an optimistic person, but you know, it's hard to turn on the news today and not see Bear Stearns, subprime, or other types of keywords and how that's impacting the overall macro economy. And I'd have to say it's not just in the United States. There's a concern that after the Olympics, the Chinese economy could slow down, that Europe will feel the impact of the United States' lack of spending. And you know what? As much as people like to believe it's only on TV and it's only for CNN purposes, it does impact how IT and how your budgets may be allocated going forward. And we certainly believe that there's an economic recession happening, and that it will have an impact on how people spend their IT, you know, their scarce IT dollars in 2008 and beyond. The second thing that we constantly see in our discussions and our research is an energy shortage. This goes well beyond Al Gore and hybrid cars. This is organizations taking an effort to be green themselves, but also just to do the right thing for their business because they cannot get access to power. And one example that I'll share with you, I'll give you an anecdote of somebody that had significant power issues. And, you know, whether we like to believe it or not, power consumption is a problem, and optimizing that is something that is hitting the tops of minds of many organizations today. And lastly, there's certainly, even though Elliott Spitzer seems to be out of office right now, the dynamic regulatory and legal climate is only going to increase. Certainly, privacy laws and information retention laws continue to be pervasive both in the United States and abroad. Japan's version of Sarbanes-Oxley, the European Union Telecommunications Act, and so on. Also, electronic discovery, while this is a predominantly a United States phenomenon, it does impact the United Kingdom and other countries that have significant multinational companies that do business in the United States. We asked organizations of all sizes, from small to mid-sized businesses up to the largest enterprises, to compare electronic discovery events between 2005 and 2007, almost every category of company size had a dramatic increase. And whether it's producing emails or producing phone records or other types of content, we believe this is going to continue. And if we map the current conditions to some of the challenges and what that means from an IT standpoint, despite the fact we're in an economic recession, organizations continue to save and create a large amount of data. And meeting with a bank recently, they're going to double their capacity from 1 petabyte to 2 petabyte this year. So it doesn't really matter the impact of what financial services is going through. They're still generating more information, and as we'll go through, they're still saving a lot of information. From that standpoint, if you have an economic recession and you don't have budget resources, but you do have performance constraints, one of which Julie was talking about at the onset of this discussion, if performance is an issue, most often organizations can solve that by buying more hardware. On the energy resource management side, organizations trying to consolidate and get more denser systems, not having multiple underutilized devices, whether it's servers or storage. Also, the ability to retire legacy applications because those consume valuable hardware resources. Sometimes they're running on old machines. It's not a rarity for ESG to talk with a customer that's still running Alpha and Vax machines because they have legacy applications, aged mainframes that are still under maintenance through third parties running key critical business applications. If you look at how many of those are out there, you certainly can't just unplug them, but being able to access the data and run them on more efficient power-consuming hardware. The interesting thing here is, one of the analogies that I like to use is, we can retire old appliances in our house, a washer and dryer, but every now and then we want to keep something around just because we think it works best for us, whether it be, a big jumbo washing machine that can fit all of our children's clothes in. But yet we don't realize how much money it's costing us from a power consumption standpoint. And I think that happens with legacy business applications. If we figure out what the hardware and the power and everything else is costing us, we may take a different approach. And lastly, if we map the dynamic legal and regulatory climate, we've got to figure out how to secure more information despite the fact that we're increasing it, if we're doubling it or even increasing it at 50 to 60%. Information security rules and laws don't care how much information you have. They care about how you protect it and what methods and processes you do take to secure it. It's very challenging. If we keep more information and we're creating more information, the lastly on the electronic discovery side that makes life much more difficult is we're saving it, we're securing it, but we also need to access it because of legal preservation requirements. We need to make sure we can search through database records and be able to produce something that may incriminate a criminal or may incriminate somebody that was doing insider trading. If you're a bank and you've been involved in subprime and you've had multiple dealings with mortgage brokers, there's a good chance that attorney generals and the like will ask for a lot of different information. And the ability to access that, whether it's from 3 years, 5 years, maybe even 7 years ago, is going to be key going forward. All of these challenges, all of these macroeconomic conditions map to real and true IT business problems create a balancing act. And I'm going to go through briefly what some of those balancing acts are and what's out there, maybe tipping the scale in one way or the other. The first is retention. Organizations retain information for a variety of reasons, but the fact is that if you keep more, there's usually a corollary of storage costs. Now, it's very rare, if you keep pictures at home, you usually end up buying bigger hard drives. Same thing happens in IT environments, in enterprise IT environments. The more we have to save, the more hardware we tend to buy. Unfortunately, we tend to buy the same profile of hardware. We always buy the most expensive or better performing device for even our legacy information. The other thing we always have to consider, especially with electronic discovery these days, is if we start to buy cheaper, less accessible storage, whether it be tape or some other offline device, what is the risk that we're going to eventually have to go after it and access it because an attorney or an internal auditor or another external party asked for us to produce that information? Sometimes the cost to produce information, even in a short period of time, far outweighs just making an investment in more accessible hardware. So just to give you an understanding, you may see this in your own environment, but what's driving retention? Regulations such as Sarbanes-Oxley, keeping audit records around, employment laws, and many of customers, including ones that utilize the Solex solution, were dealing with international employment law. And these require people to keep, you know, everything from resumes down to benefits and salary information for six years and above. One thing that I put up there, sunshine laws. In the United States, state and local governments actually require information regarding employment of state employees, as well as everything from school committee meeting notes to water resources and how those are being utilized and allocated as far as utility rates go. These sunshine laws, which are pretty prevalent in almost any state, do impact how local and governments spend their money on IT dollars. In this, I can share with you HIPAA, the healthcare industry. I can talk to you about very specific retention laws over in Europe regarding the Financial Services Agency. The fact of the matter is these legislative bodies, whether it's at the country level, the international level, or just down to maybe city and local government, they all have a couple of things in common. They all want us to keep more information for longer periods of time. We are also retaining information for electronic discovery purposes. Once an inquiry begins, usually IT is asked by corporate counsel to put information on quote-unquote preservation or legal hold. Now, given that the legal system in the United States, especially if it involves some international types of companies or grabbing information from international sources, can take a long period of time. And by the time it gets through the system and we're preserving information, that makes us keep information on legal hold for up to 4, 5, even 6, 7 years. The interesting thing is, even at the outset, a lot of our research indicates that most data requested to be produced is older than 36 months. So we're looking at 3-year lag times of having to produce information and then preserve it for an incremental 4 to 5, even 6 or 7 years. The thing that's difficult is you have to ensure during legal preservation that it cannot be modified or deleted. The legal risk of if that happens can increase substantially. Many of our financial services enterprises have had to pay significant fines for failing to preserve legal electronic evidence during the life of a case or a particular regulatory inquiry. The other thing, it's not all doom and gloom in my opinion. We're also saving more information for longer periods of time because we're making better business decisions based on the information at hand. If we have historical figures on sales or we have better insight as to our hiring trends, we can actually make better business decisions. So information in this case is truly a business asset. But all in all, these three things are driving information retention in our opinion. The second balancing act is, as Julie pointed out, a lot of organizations are doing significant R&D, and you're trying to keep up with Oracle releases or other databases, application upgrades. And you want to make sure you can stay on top of these things. You're doing these upgrades for security purposes. You're doing these upgrades in order to drive more revenue or potentially reduce costs of maintenance. And the challenge is while you're going through this and creating your copies of data, you have to balance that with the security and privacy rules. Record retention regulations aren't the only ones that make life difficult for us these days. Security and privacy rules have certainly become more prevalent, and as I'll point out to you, the stats are quite staggering as far as where these laws may go. Currently, 35 states in the United States have breach laws. We've all heard about TJX issue where a number of credit card numbers and customer information from their retail environment was lost. There's 4 laws in front of the United States Congress that impact information privacy and security. That would federalize some of these breach laws. The thing, you know, we hear about TJX and maybe retail more often than not, but recently, as of last week, there was some risk of employees in the state of Georgia having their information lost due to access to an application. And it's happened across education, as I said, the government, as well as the finance industry. So the more information we have, the likelihood that, especially in key critical applications, there's an increased likelihood that we're saving something that is sensitive or confidential, and we don't want to have inappropriate folks, including internal employees, to have access to it. In Europe, there's approximately 15 countries that have their own privacy laws, along with the European Union Privacy Directive. And, of course, there are other regulations, like payment card, that are industry-specific, like the payment card industry standard, HIPAA and healthcare. This is a double-edged sword. It requires us to keep information, like medical records, for the life of a patient, but yet it also has a security angle, and some of that information cannot be accessed. One of the most recent examples have been celebrity, where George Clooney's medical records were accessed in the state of New Jersey. Also, two of our presidential candidates here in the United States had passport information accessed inappropriately. So there's certainly more and more evidence that privacy is going to be of top of mind for the near future, and our expectation, especially some of these laws passed, is that it could be federalized and become more of a challenge for ID departments managing applications that contain sensitive data. Another balancing act is this thought of performance. Everybody wants to go faster. They want to have access to their applications. And yet, the ability to make things go faster may not be economically feasible, because just adding server processing power or adding more additional storage hardware won't necessarily solve the problem altogether, and it can be very, very expensive. So weighing the cost of how fast your application goes versus how much the hardware costs, and keep in mind that the other thing is, servers and storage do consume power. They consume valuable data center real estate, and if those resources are tight for you, you may want to think about how we can get better performance without keeping throwing dollars at hardware. The performance paradigm, in the ESG's opinion, has to do with three things. One, as we've gone through first, there's more and more data to be kept, and thus we're straining our existing IT systems. Application response times tend to go down as more data resides within the databases and other sources. There's more to do with the data. We now can take better action. We run nightly reports, maybe even daily, multiple times per day, on loading data warehouses so we can conduct business analytics. The other thing that impacts performance is who actually is using the data. Mobile users now approving things within an ERP system, looking at purchase orders online, checking budgets, hiring status, moving things along. People are doing it on their PDAs now, and that requires a different level of access. We also have more and more super users, people that can do more with applications. When you take all of these things into consideration, people don't want to wait if they're on their PDA to get access to, their finance, see how revenue's tracking. And as well as the super users, if they're running a whole bunch of different things in order to get their jobs done, performance is key. So how do we create this balance? And from our perspective, the database archiving and management opportunities that it provides, the ability to create subsets so we're not making full copies, scrambling information, masking it. The list keeps going, but the key here is we're making investments that there's not so much of a significant trade-off. As an example, if we continue to buy more hardware, we have to worry about real estate space, we have to worry about power consumption, and we have to worry about the hardware budget. If we continue to do the same thing that we've always been doing, we are going to run into a wall and that balance gets out of whack. The ability to archive data to different tiers of storage, not always buying the same profile of hardware. There's less power, if we're buying bigger, slower devices, the power consumptions are entirely different. If we are subject to those electronic discoveries, I think our research shows that 5 out of 10 electronic discovery events involve database records, along with customer invoices and other things. If we're going to have to figure out how to find old database information, we want to make sure that our databases and those records are indexed and searchable and can be searched in a quick period of time. Time is money in those legal scenarios. The ability to archive legacy applications, the ability to create subsets, all of these things create a much better balancing act than some of the alternatives of just buying more hardware or buying more processing power or running the risk that information isn't properly secured when we're trying to do upgrades and get to the latest version of Oracle apps. So if you believe in a balancing act is the right way to go, there's some key questions that ESG always recommends customers and in certain types of customers as to see if database archiving could be right for you. The first is really just understand your database growth. Our research shows it's somewhere around 25% per annum for the primary databases with across organizations. And now some people may be growing faster, some may be going slower. But if you think about that, they may double roughly every 3 years. The second thing is how much of your database data is active. Are you storing this information on primary storage devices? Are you running it on Tier 1 enterprise class servers? Is the fact that you're saving a lot of information that's really not being accessed on these power, you know, these very dense, more expensive, could, you know, significant power draws, is this data slowing your database down? The other things for IT to consider is during the test and development process or during, you know, reporting, are you creating full copies where you could be creating a subset? The other thing is, if you start to try to manage your historical data, does it need to be accessible for electronic discoveries? Can you run queries, or do you have to create all of these unique custom scripts in order to do that? The ability to create all of these activities and running reports and queries and data house loads, can you do it on time? These are some of the questions that I think can lead to, and the answer doesn't have to be yes for all of them, but if you think about it, if you have more than one of, if you can answer yes or you have some of these challenges, database archiving may make sense, and I'll get into some of the use cases in a second here. But if you happen to be a compliance officer or work with compliance officers, you know, making sure that you understand record retention laws, the ability to, you know, do you have the requirement to save information? Are you handling electronic records different from paper records, where most of our information is being born digital? Folks that are printing out paper records and shipping them off-site, that may not be the most cost-effective way, especially if you have to get those records back for discovery or a compliance audit or something like that. The ability to handle electronic records in the face of regulations is key. The second area is how much of your database information contains confidential or very sensitive information. Do you have intellectual property? Do you have credit card numbers? And who has access, both external and internal parties, to that information? This, you know, essentially this data security map is something that most organizations have gotten into the public headlines for a breach, wish they had. If you take a look at, you know, I repeated the last bullet there for a reason. If you really think about it and you're retaining more information and you've got subject to privacy concerns, have you taken into account historical records, electronic records, security rules? Have you taken into account all of the information that you create and store in a database on a regular basis? Have you included legacy applications? This is an area that I do not believe compliance officers know enough about, and bringing IT and compliance to the table to help understand that is worth repeating. Making sure that everybody's on the same page is critical. And lastly, I brought up the electronic discovery notion, and that it's a frequent thing, and it's not going to go away. We've had the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, which outline the processes that organizations have to follow as far as way in the legal system essentially dictates of how we handle civil matters, and recent amendments in December of 2006 had significant, recommendations and procedures as far as how to handle electronically stored information. So if you're a corporate counsel, you happen to work with corporate counsel, how much of your discovery events involve information within a database? How accessible is that information? The key here, in my opinion, is if you do get requested, how quickly can you get that data back? Are you going to have to hire forensic legal service providers, or you're going to have to outsource this process? How expensive is that? The other thing that I think is the biggest challenge right now for organizations in the electronic discovery process is evidence preservation. Once you get asked to produce it, can you preserve it? Can you prevent people from going in there, including rogue employees, from deleting it? This is very, very important, and I think it's going to play a big role in our legal system as it relates to electronic discovery. E-discovery is not a fad. It's not going to go away anytime soon. The last thing is, audit trails, can you prove that these records haven't changed? Is there a level of authenticity and integrity around your database records? Because the last thing you want to do is preserve all your information, and somebody questions its integrity, and you can't provide audit trails or access logs to who's been able to change it or has it been changed at all. Because you saved all the evidence, and now it can't be admissible in court or in any type of hearing. It's kind of a useless exercise. You want to make sure that if you preserve it, you can prove its authenticity and integrity. And I brought up, after looking at the questions that certain constituents within an organization can ask, I wanted to go back to the first comment I made about the economic recession. You know, you may ask, well, that's great, Enterprise Strategy Group, but why do we need to make an investment now? You know, we can certainly spend our dollars elsewhere, and we may think it's better just to buy more processing power than invest in software. Well, I think what you're going to see, you know, the answer to the question is we can keep doing things the old way and continue to figure out if we can manage through the power issues or we can, you know, piece together a legal service provider solution to handle electronic discovery. But those are all expensive after the fact. We don't realize the secondary cost. We don't realize the risk that we're run to keep, you know, we don't realize that if we, you know, if you're TJX, what that public relations cost is. And so my opinion is if you're going to make an investment now that changes the way you do things. And I put a couple of case studies here in the end of my presentation based on conversations with Solex customers, and they really center around the ability to solve multiple problems that has to do with retention or performance enhancements or reducing storage costs or being able to mitigate security and privacy risks or handling electronic discovery. And as you can see here, the first one I showed is Roberts and Chico, and they had to deal with retaining information for compliance purposes. They had to deal with, because they retained so much information, they had performance problems. And just instead of solving one problem by throwing hardware at it or being able to, or just printing out records for SEC, they were able to use database archiving through the Solex solution to solve all of these. In the discussions I had, you know, there were more and more business benefits that they were thinking about they could have, including some storage cost impact, just by making one investment as opposed to, you know, handling a whole bunch of other different things or finding point solutions. Helen of Troy is another good example, a great conversation that I had. I mean, one of the biggest challenges was retaining information in different applications of part of their Oracle E-Business Suite for different retention periods. So they had to keep some things for 1 year, some for three, and some for a lot longer. And their storage costs and handling all of these things was just out of control. Very unique Oracle E-Business environment, and Helen of Troy makes a lot of different consumer products that you may know, like Vidal and other brand names, and just the ability for them to manage storage space, handle multiple retention periods was worth their while at looking at a database archiving solution. And the last one, which I found very compelling, was this really impacted their business. They were running reports, and they couldn't finish because of the size of the database. They couldn't get all their reporting exercises done. Those reporting exercises actually determined the manufacturing plant, and if they couldn't manufacture, they didn't generate revenue. And as I'll show, the last one here, I couldn't use the company name, but an IT, a technology component supplier, had one of these, they actually had to deal with employment laws of retaining information, and they had to keep their financial data accessible for auditing purposes. As a result of these compliance challenges and accessibility requirements, performance tanked, and they needed to be able to improve that performance. So, looking at a solution like Solex has solved multiple issues for this publicly traded component supplier. I've shared a couple of quotes that I was able to obtain through my case studies and my market perspective, and I put on top of them some of the business and IT benefits, but, you know, really as I've gone through this, think about that balancing act and the ability for Traco to run its business more efficiently. There's no revenue risk now with the fact that they're, you know, archiving information and they can get their reports done. Avoiding unwanted headlines. Traco didn't have this issue, but I go back to the TJX or the State of Georgia or some institution that had to deal with the public relations nightmare of having a security breach. The ability to comply with record retention regulations and privacy laws at lower cost, not saving all information on primary storage. The ability to respond to electronic discovery requests in a short period of time. Preserve evidence so that you don't have what we call an adverse opinion where you think you're deleting data on purpose and that would be incriminating. The other thing is many business user, business application owners know there's nothing better than happy users and the phone's not ringing. You don't have to deal with IT support and help desk requests. So keeping our users and keeping our business running without impacting the bottom line is one of the business benefits, or a multiple of business benefits of why investments now make sense and some of the things that you should think about measuring if you do decide to make an investment. Here's another one, the performance. You know, I separated performance into the IT benefits, but thinking about how you can improve or improve storage utilization, reduce storage costs by not having to buy the same types of systems. If you archive before you back up, you can remove data from the backup process and you'll get your backups or potentially your disaster recovery operations completed faster. Many people don't do DR today because their data sizes are too big. One of the things here that I wanted to bring up is in a conversation with a large United Kingdom telecommunications provider, it took them 18 months to get new power provision to one of their data centers. If they continued to buy hardware at the rate that they were buying at to support many of their business activities, they weren't going to be able to plug all of those devices in. So they were going to be paying maintenance and going through three-year technology cycles without even having power to the systems. I don't know how long it is for you to provision power in your data center, but if you can even avoid that conversation by going a different route, by controlling capital expenditures, it's much warranted. And I've been talking for a long time, but here are some things that that I think you should consider. If you buy into the concept that these problems are real, that the challenges exist, and that you think you can make an investment now to avoid any costs down the road, look for something that's integrated with prepackaged and custom applications. The ability to build metadata maps so you can access data wherever it sits. Making sure that the database profile that you have is supported by the vendor. We've had a recent Oracle refresh with 11G, making sure that's on the checklist. The other thing, too, is that database archiving can deliver a number of benefits if the solution has a comprehensive feature set. You don't want to buy something that, you know, can be multi-purpose and you realize it doesn't have the search feature to make electronic discovery more possible, or the fact that you can't integrate it with a storage system so you can preserve evidence. Or you can't mask data for security. You want to make sure that the feature set's there so you can derive multiple benefits. With that, I think I wanted to
make sure that we turned it back over to Solix to take any of your questions, and I appreciate the opportunity. Hopefully it wasn't all doom and gloom, that you saw the opportunities that exist with database archiving. And really, making an investment now does make some sense, despite what many people out there say.
Great. Thank you so much, Brian. I think there's a lot of valuable information and insight into the presentation and the information that you've presented. What I'd like to do right now is we have quite a few questions in the queue. And for those of you who have been waiting, go ahead and submit them. And we will spend the next 10 minutes or so answering them. And should the questions continue, we'll take the audio portion online and continue to provide the answers through the WebEx.